journey to the Kingdom of Glory. Indeed, on Saturday, January 8, 1994, while I was participating in the praise, I was touched in my place by the spirit of adoption. I then saw Jesus in the middle of the church hall, measuring about 5 meters high, dressed in a robe white glowing. If you saw his eyes, they were overflowing with love and holiness. He watched the crowd with love. I fell under his presence to the point where I could not get up. I lost all notion of space and of time. They carried me before the pastor. I felt Jesus' hands resting on my forehead, and I was suddenly projected backwards under the power of the Holy Spirit. I did not understand what was going on. It was then that I discovered another world around me. I could not believe what I saw. This world that opened before my eyes was real. Perhaps surprising to you, I was at peace, and I knew that I was not dead or in danger. I was like a newborn who discovered the new world that surrounded him. Suddenly I found myself sitting on a bench of white marble beside a man dressed in white in a huge garden. I did not understand what was going on. I looked at the person by my side. He smiled at me in silence, as if he wanted to reassure me. He was an angel. I knew it not because he told me, but because it was like an intuition in me. Contrary to popular belief, he had no wings and did not, strictly speaking, wear a dress such as we might imagine. It is surely difficult to understand. The angel was dressed in garment, but not the way we can imagine it. He was enveloped in light, and it appears like a robe, and he was beautiful. I looked around. I could not believe my eyes. Nothing corresponded to what I knew until then. The landscape was splendid, of a perfect beauty. All terrestrial landmarks were not worth of this place. Understand that the most beautiful landscape on earth is bland compared to this garden. Certainly I was in another dimension. The color of the garden was green, but of a green so pure that it seemed bright with light. I never seen such a hue on the surface of the earth. This garden extended on hectares, and it was immense. The sky was not blue like on earth, but of gold color. It looked like it was filled with a reverberation. This reverberation seemed to come from a powerful source of light. I knew that it was the throne of God. I turned my eyes and I saw beings in the garden. Some seemed to talk, others were walking around. None of them was astonished at my presence. It seemed that they knew me, and they knew that I was there by the invitation of the Holy Spirit. They all manifested a true and unfaltering friendship. Nevertheless, I was astonished to see that this large garden was almost empty. But when I turned around, I realized that there was on the other side a multitude kneeling in adoration. The people of God were attending the worship service. Hallelujah! There was such an atmosphere, such a peace. This place breathed love. I really had the impression that the oxygen of this dimension was love. My companion explained to me that the saints present in this place came from a specific place in the city, a surprising detail for me. When the angel spoke to me, I could hear him in my heart without him speaking one word. Nevertheless, at other times the celestial beings spoke with their voices. I then saw several transparent and resplendent houses. They seemed to be made of crystal. The angel told me that these houses were arranged around the throne of the Father, and that the general plan of the celestial city was according to the model of the architecture of the Temple of Jerusalem. The throne of God was in the place of the Holy of Holies, and the dwellings of the saints turned to God as towards a son, and these dwellings surrounded this throne. We will be in these habitations, in the eternal presence of our God. Our Lord Jesus prepared them for us. They are waiting for us. My attention was attracted by a river, a sort of spring which crossed this garden sinuously. It was just before our feet. I looked at this water and I noticed that it was so transparent and pure that it could scarcely be seen. It was crystal water. I tried to find out where it came from, but I could not. Then I turned to my companion and I asked him to see God. I was very excited, like a child, but when I reflect on this request today, I realize how daring it was to do it. But it seemed that the angel himself understood that it was the fruit of a pure desire to see the glory of my Father. At that moment I was suddenly projected toward the source of the light. It was a real concentration of pure power. We often speak of atomic force, which is great and strong, but compared to the power of God, all earthly powers are but nothing. My friends, it's hard for me to find words to describe what I felt, but I found myself surrounded, soaked by the light. It gave me the impression of a strong wind, powerful but yet the sweetest caresses. This power and glorious wave of light enveloped me and penetrated me at the same time. I was so insignificant to this greatness. I was in the presence of my father, he was in the light, but he was there. I saw not his face but merely the glory of his glory. The only sight of this brilliance had literally crushed me. Imagine what the sight of his glory, even his face, would have created. He was in the light. He was one with the light. He was himself the light. God is light and there is no darkness in him. He did not utter a word from his mouth, but I knew the greatness of his love for me and I felt the sweetness of his gaze on me. It seemed that only his look spoke to me and cuddled me. My friends, how can you explain such a sensation? I was literally soaked and drowned in his love. There was such a power emanating from him, greater than all the powers of our earth, but this all power did not prevent him from having extreme delicacy in him. People of the earth, worship the eternal God, for he is worthy of our worship. Our God surpasses all that we can imagine. Man is such a microscopic particle of dust before his greatness, and yet humanity is the object of the perfect and eternal love from his Creator. Praise the Lord, we have a wonderful God. He is the very source of love. Nothing in him expresses wickedness and evil. He is holy. I would like to share with you what I feel, but I cannot perfectly for lack of precise words. Just be sure of the Father's love for us. He is so great, so powerful, so majestic, but he is so close to us, so small, so simple in his greatness. It's sensational. My soul bless the Lord my God. Thou art wonderfully great, majesty and magnificence. He wraps itself in light like a cloak. I witnessed a scene majestic. I saw the Father's throne covered from above by heavenly beings that seemed to have wings spread out, such as a swarm of bees. The source of light emanating from the throne made them brighter, of a scarlet white. They were by the thousands. It was marvelously beautiful to behold. Do not ask me who these beings were. I could not answer you. These beings had the appearance of the angels I had seen before, but apart from these sorts of deployed wings and the radiance that emanated from them, I would say that they came out of them a greater glory. I was in the middle of a column of light. It had multiple shimmering colors, and it was of brightening light and white. I turned my head and saw around me children sitting on a lawn, aged apparently 1 or 2 years old. They were rejoicing and they were radiant with joy. I heard the song of the angels and began to dance for my God. I realized that I was surrounded by other celestial beings who were also dancing. Do not ask me to describe these songs to you, although having musical notions I will be in the impossibility of doing so. This moment was delightful. At that moment something terrifying happened. I found myself in front of a holy seraph. My friends, I use the term terrifying because these beings are so filled with the glory of God that they truly awaken a newer kind of terror mingled with respect. His hair was as thick as golden wool, his eyes were like two consuming flames, his face shone with the presence of God. He was dressed in a sort of scarlet robe and was surrounded by a powerful wind that filled his hair and his clothes. I felt truly tiny and miserable in front of him. I stood as if I was paralyzed. The seraph stood motionless and spoke no word. He looked at me sympathetically. After this scene I looked and I noticed that the spring that crossed the garden and the eternal kingdom came from the base of the Father's throne. In the same way I saw that the top of the throne was crowned with several rainbows, beaming with light and sparkling in pure colors. This spectacle was wonderful. Then my attention was drawn to the source of the crystal river. I was allowed to see where its water was pouring. Then I saw a great waterfall at the limit of the celestial kingdom. It was pouring down below, precisely to our dimension. Several houses of the earth was the destination of this crystal river, including the assemblies of the people of God on all the surface of the earth, not those buildings bearing various names, where Christians meet from time to time, but the places where even 2 or 3 redeemed from Christ invoke his name. Such is the true assembly in the vocabulary of the kingdom. The river was crystal colored in the kingdom of God, but when it reached our dimension it was changing to golden tint. People of God, the Holy Spirit descended directly from the throne of God to you. We can bathe in the sweetness and freshness of this water whenever we desire it. These words of Jesus are true, for where two or three are gathered together in my name I am there in the midst of them. Jesus said, Everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks the water I give him will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give him will become in him a fountain of water springing up to eternal life. My companion told me to look around. I turned and I saw several people around me. He introduced me to them. They were Samuel, Moses, Elijah, Samson. They surrounded me and welcomed me joyfully. I really felt like I was expected. It was a warm atmosphere. They held me by the shoulders and they welcomed me like longtime friends who met again. My attention was attracted by a woman among them, who was remarkable for her discretion. I knew that it was Mary, the mother of Jesus. She was on the same level as all the redeemed. Her face was so soft. She was dressed in a pastel-colored dress, and I could see under a thin veil and almost transparent her beautiful black hair. She is a very beautiful woman, very calm or even erased, having a true mother's look. In truth, it was what touched me in her. I had the impression that my mother was looking at me. She smiled tenderly at me. I turned to my companion and asked him if I could see Jesus Christ. Even before I finished making my request, I saw him. He was right there in front of me smiling. His face was wonderfully beautiful. I cannot describe it to you. His eyes shone with such flame and life that they almost burst into flames. I felt almost exploded by the love I felt for him and that he projected on my soul by his presence. His face was transparent to the point where I could see his features and see through. Yes, you read well. I saw his features and yet I saw through his features, my friends. These things are so pure and so unusual that I cannot find precise words to describe them to you. But know that Jesus Christ, the Son of God, is not the Jesus described by many with a sad look, imploring eyes with a divine pity and a face so empty of life. Jesus is radiant with life, radiant with sweetness and majesty. That is the right word, majesty. Our Savior is majestic. His eyes devour you and fill you with peace, calm and love. I will never forget these eyes. It emanates from him a true wave of love, peace and joy. I love you, my Savior. Love him. He deserves our respect and adoration. He spoke to me and told me that the world had already received this revelation, but that the devil had come and had diverted some of these men into idolatry. He told me that he bore the pain of the world with the church. Friends, God suffers for the world. He is not indifferent to the pains of his creatures. Do not believe the lies of the devil who portray God as a severe or even indifferent being who takes pleasure in seeing men suffer. Jesus loves us and carries us into his bosom. He wants the repentance of the greatest number because he died on the cross for all men. In my second visit to the kingdom of heaven, I saw the gates of the celestial kingdom. They were gigantic. They were more than 50 meters tall and two mighty angels stood on either side. The walls gave me the feeling that they were filled with the power of God. I looked and I saw a high mountain above the firmament with a lively light. Then we reached the garden again. This time around it was filled with people. I found that they were all dressed in the purest white. Then the angel showed me a building. It was like crystal and full of light. It seemed transparent, but I could not see what was inside. We went there and we enter. I was marked by the absence of disorder. Everything seemed to be in its place. There were plenty of books on the walls, and yet the place was full of light. It seemed to me it was a kind of library or archive room. It was huge. The angel told me that these were the books that bore the names of the saints. The angel took one without moving his hand. It was as if the book had just appeared in his hands. The page of the book resembled the parchment. He opened it and I saw my name marked. I also saw the lines being written without the aid or intervention of anybody. It was as if these writing were written with fire. It was not written with an ink but with fire. If I dared, I would say that this book was alive. The angel told me that these lines or writing were the works performed for the kingdom by the saints. The lines were continually written during their terrestrial existence. By some process unknown, the book writes on pages the works of the disciples of Christ. I mean, this fire was writing the works of the saints on the blank pages of book. Nothing is left to be forgotten. Realize that the eye of Jesus does not lose us a single second. He showed me another book and showed me the name of a brother of my acquaintance who had backslidden. He told me that he would return to the Lord. I keep this word in my heart and await the fulfillment. He also spoke to me about marriage, couples in Christ, and he showed me another book. I saw the book, but it was peculiar indeed. There was not a single name but two, and the page was separated in two. There were thus two columns in one page. The works of each of the spouses were separated but listed on the same page. Whatever some of our contemporaries think, there is real unity in marriage. It has repercussions even in the kingdom of heaven. Thus, when Jehovah sees a man or a woman, he see him husband or wife, they shall become one flesh. Genesis 2 verse 24. Husbands and wives, meditate on your attitude towards your spouse. You are linked even in the eternal kingdom. Brothers, we have a responsibility as heads of family, because everything related and connected from the earth and in the heavens. Take care of the spiritual growth of your wives. This building was full of angels. They had control over this room. There was an atmosphere activity, but not disorder. Everyone was focused on his task. We got out of it and flew over this building. I could see from above and in the distance a throne of light. We then returned to the heavenly garden. I saw a large table. It was huge, in fact it was several kilometers long, covered with a white tablecloth with the same motifs as on the garments of the saints. Cutlery and cuts of gold had been prepared as for a feast. I saw many golden crowns placed in front of these cutlery. They were marvelously and beautiful. They were covered with precious stones delicately worked. It seemed as if a name was on the front of each one of these crown. Angels were standing, and carrying jars filled with the fruit of the vine. Others angels were ready to serve food. My friends, one thing is certain, everything is ready for the big day. May this give you thought, and especially you who read this book and have not accepted Jesus in your life. Every day brings us closer to this day when God will take away his church. Be ready, for at the hour when you do not think, the Son of Man will come. The day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. Let us not sleep like others, but watch and be sober. The angel took me to another building. This one was filled with crowns and robes. There was also an inscription, resembling Hebrew, at the level of the chest of the robes and on the front the crowns. The angel says that these crowns were for the saints. The crowns had luminous jewels of a thousand colors, and they were of pure gold. As for the dresses, they had the color of linen with ringlets of the color of the curdled blood. My companion told me that these robes would become scarlet white when the saints would put them on. He added that there was not one dress more or less. Everything was counted according to the number of saints. The Father knows all things. He knows every one of us by name. But the angel insisted that the gospel should be preached for the salvation of those who remained. Then we entered a room. I saw the clothes of the saints ready. Beloved, these garments were woven by the hand of angels. They were of the color of linen, bearing an inscription on the chest. On this garment there were sorts of patterns with the shape of sparks, the color of crimson. Believe me, it's a marvel. Each of these robes are intended for a specific saint, not for another. Nothing is done roughly in the kingdom. Everything is counted and weighed. Jesus was standing at the golden gate. My friends, he seemed like a child impatient to receive gift. He really jumped with joy and impatience. This may seem absurd or childish. His face was radiant with joy and pure innocence. He was emitting innocence of children. If you want to imagine what I'm trying to describe, look at a small child. I would have loved so much you might see him. Many would be shaken in their conception of our Savior. Jesus told me how impatient he is to receive his church, squeeze his children into his arms, to welcome them into the kingdom and into the houses which he has prepared for them. Consider that the church is a true passion for Christ. Jesus conceives things, speaks, acts by this passion for his body. The love of Son of God for his brothers, and men more widely, is more immense than the universe. I felt a strong love for us in his voice, and he was radiating so much inner sense that I had the impression of talking with a child filled with the wisdom of God. How I love you, Jesus. Jesus gave me these words to convey to his church. Tell my people that I love them. Tell my people that I want them to abide with me forever. I love you. I am waiting for you. He then showed me a wonderful scene. I saw a tent. There were satin cushions, fur rugs, precious objects inside. What struck me most was the smell that embalmed it, a sweet and pleasant scent. There was a warm atmosphere. We came out of it. I then saw the entrance of the kingdom. A virgin appeared, of a beautiful face. She was veiled. Angels welcomed her and took her to this tent. At that moment I saw the Prince of Life, delighted at his arrival, joining her in the nuptial tent. I heard then songs of joy and laughter of rejoicing. Jesus showed me in a metaphoric and prophetic way his encounter with his church, a symbol that should make us meditate. He then showed me a basket of wicker. It was filled with stones. He passed his hand over the top of the basket. A white light descended on the stones. I was amazed to see that they had become precious stones, sparkling with a thousand lights. By the operation of the Holy Spirit, ordinary stones were turned into precious stones. Jesus told me that these stones represented the people that the Father had reserved for him and that were on the earth. He who is in Christ has a new nature comparable to the most coveted precious stones sparkling with a thousand lights. I understood at that moment how much the gift of life of Jesus was miraculous and precious. My Savior then parted from me. Then the angel of the Lord insisted on a specific point in these terms. He said, God loves you, He cares about you, He descends into your lives and cares about the least details of your life. He loves you and does not want to lose any of those He has chosen. That is the reason He is delaying His return. Pray for the retrograde that they may return to the Lord. Pray for one another. Do care about each other so that you may be united. Great attacks are coming against you. The only weapon is fervent prayer and a holy life, and in the name of Jesus. Without these things there is no victory. Let each one analyze and weigh the pros and cons. You can refuse this fight, but you will lose many blessings. Be simple as children, simply simple. Have respect for the Holy Spirit because the time of Pentecost is there.